I spoke with writer, director, producer, actor, and philanthropist Tyler Perry about the state of race in America, his views on Confederate monuments, as well as John Lewis and police reform. Tyler, you recently wrote about Race in People magazine, and one of the things you wrote, you said, it's my hope that as we continue these hard conversations and come out of our respective corners to talk to each other, but most of all to hear, we got to start hearing each other so that this pain, this grief, this mourning in America will give way to mourning in America. I found that really powerful, and you know, I was thinking about this yesterday. The Attorney General of the United States, Bill Barr, said he doesn't believe there is systemic racism in police departments. If you were to have a conversation with Barr, what would you want him to hear?
Well, wow, that's what a great question. There are many things I would want him to hear, but more than anything, just to understand the journey of someone who is black in America. Even me sitting here talking to you now at 50 years old, all the things that I've accomplished, all the things that I've overcome, I still get pulled over by police. Some recognize me, some don't, because I'm in a nice car in a neighborhood that they don't even know that I live in until they realize it's me. So I would want him to understand that there is bias, there are those things. And here's the greatest gift that I've been given is I've been able to live on both sides of the wealth gap. I've been extremely poor and I've managed to do very, very well. And I understand how someone can come to that conclusion when you live in your own world, when you live in your own bubble, and you're not even open to hearing or seeing it another way. So I understand how he got there, but his thinking is very wrong.
Are you optimistic now in a way that you haven't been before, when you see the protests that are taking place, when you see the outpouring of people of all colors?
I was very optimistic. I was very optimistic, you know, at the horror of what happened after the death of George Floyd. I became optimistic when I saw so many people get it. It was the same thing that happens during the Civil Rights Movement, when people saw on television what happened on the Edmund Pettus Bridge, what happened with Bull Connor, what happened in all of these moments. When people saw it, when white people saw it, they got engaged, they wanted to help. So when they saw George Floyd's death, this horrific, horrible death played out, as this man pleaded for his life and begged, said please many, many times, seeing it changes everything. So I became very, very optimistic when everybody galvanized together, because I know that's when change comes, when people galvanize and come together as one. That's when change happens. But lately I've been very, very concerned that the message is being hijacked by some other groups or political ads and parties that are trying to stop the message of what we're asking for here is police reform. Right? So, yeah, I was, but I'm worried now is because of what I'm seeing.
Your son is 5 years old, and, yeah. You know, obviously having a child changes one's perspective on things and makes you see things with a fresh eyes in many senses. I know he's 5 years old. Have you had a conversation with him about race? I know it's something you've written about, just the feeling of, gosh, I'm going to have this conversation sometime soon.
Yeah, I don't want to listen to me. I'm trying to push that as long as I can, because there's something about the level of innocence that's ripped from a child when they have to face race. Like, I love watching him play with his friends or coming home from school and talk about his friends, never describing them by race at all, ever, not once in these years that he's been talking and smart enough to ask me all kinds of questions. So my hope is that I can keep it from him as long as I can. But I know that being his father, being a black man in America, enduring the things that I've done, I'm going to have that conversation with him. And I know it's coming soon. I know it's going to be painful. But I want to listen, if I can let him hold on to that innocence just for another day, I'm going to give him that.
Hmm. Your great-great-grandfather was enslaved in this country. You are also the owner of the largest movie studio in the U.S., which just happens to be built on what was a military base for the Confederate Army. The arc of that is an extraordinary thing. The president is arguing that Confederate statues, monuments are part of our heritage. As somebody who's a storyteller, what story do you think these statues tell you and us, and should they come down?
For me, I grew up in New Orleans, and there's a circle that's called Lee Circle that takes you from where the streetcar actually goes around it to take you into the French Quarters and downtown. And you see Robert E. Lee up top, and there's a Robert E. Lee High School. So these, and listen, as a kid, I loved the Dukes of Hazzard until I realized what the flag represented as I got older. And again, that's going back to holding on to the innocence. When I see these monuments, for me, I can look at them and realize I don't need to see them in the air to understand what happened. I have this. I wear this every day. I wake up with it every day. And even in America in 2020, there's still racism that I deal with, even me, that I deal with on a constant basis in Hollywood, in the business. You know, as much as I've been able to accomplish, if people would have given me the shot to just have a fair playing field, God knows where I could be at this point. So I've always had to find a way. How do I find a way to make it inside of this? That's what my mother taught me, who grew up in the Jim Crow South. You have to find a way. So that's what I've been trying to do all these years, to find a way. So when I see these statues and these monuments, to be on this land that was once a Confederate Army base, I mean, think about the poetic justice in that, where there were Confederate soldiers plotting and planning strategy on how to keep Negroes enslaved, and now that land is owned by a Negro. That, for me, is beyond poetic justice. And there's still several streets here that are named after Confederate generals on the base that I'm changing. When you talk about my ancestors and great-great-great-grandfather, I want to change them to those names so that they can be honored as well.
You know, I read recently that you donated Kroger, I think it was gift cards, to people in the Atlanta area, and you got the Atlanta Police Department to help distribute them around to people in need. When you know, there's a large movement within protest movement of defunding police. Republicans are focusing on that as saying that, you know, the Democrats want to do away with police departments, which I don't think is what defund police means. But when you hear that slogan, what do you think?
Well, when I first heard it, I was troubled by it. I thought, okay, this is going to be weaponized in this political year. I completely thought that was happening, and that's exactly what's happened. It's been weaponized. But I did some research, and what I would challenge people to do is to do research on find out what it means. Now, you got to understand this. I'm not for taking money for the police department. I think we need more police. My studio is in a neighborhood where I think we need police, but we don't need a police that have or that are undertrained. And you got to understand, I have really close friends who are police officers that I love dearly, who are really good people, who have been very, very hurt by this as well. And here's what I want you to understand, Anderson. Wrong, where there's wrong, I'm going to stand up against it. When Rashad Brooks was murdered, I thought that was wrong. When George Floyd was murdered, I thought that was wrong, like so many other people. But when a police officer who was white in a suburb in Atlanta was shot in the head by a shoplifter, I thought that was wrong too, and I reached out to do what I can to help his family. When Sequoia was 8-year-old was shot near the Wendy's in her mother's back seat, I thought that was wrong too. So anywhere there's wrong, I'm going to stand up against it. I just don't believe that, and I believe that most. I don't believe that there are lots of people. Let me just change that to understand that there are a lot of people in America who feel the way that I do, right? I think we need the police. I know that I need the police. I have several that work for me here at the studio. We need them, but we need them reformed. We need them trained well. We need the right structure, right? But some of the things inside of Defund the Police, I really understand, like having officers who are clinically trained to deal with certain situations. I think all of those things are helpful. But taking money from the police department to make the police department smaller, that troubles me.
I want to end on just mentioning John Lewis, Congressman Lewis, and also C.T. Vivian, two extraordinary leaders who we've recently lost. There's a story I read, and if you could just quickly tell it, of a connection you had to John Lewis, which is a house you owned was once owned by a racist segregationist business person, I think it was, and John Lewis told you a story that when he learned who owned that house, of his connection to that person.
Yeah, it was. We were having a gospel brunch. We've got all these black people, you know, Oprah, all of us there, and we'd had this beautiful gospel brunch, and John Lewis was there, and I started telling the story about this former segregationist who owned a hotel in Atlanta called the Heart of Atlanta Hotel, who also owned the property that I had just bought. And when I bought the property, he had lost it in a malpractice suit, but he started suing me over and over again. And I remember walking into court and him seeing me for the first time, watching the blood drain from his face, realizing that I was a black man. So eventually I had him disbarred. I think he died a few years ago, but I had him disbarred because he kept suing. We fought and fought and fought because he had no rights for any of that, because I bought the property free and clear, fair and square. And I was telling this story among all of those people at this gospel brunch as we're celebrating on this land that he once owned. And Congressman Lewis comes up to me with tears in his eyes, and he said, I sat in at the lunch counter at his hotel to integrate it. And for me, it was like, what an incredible moment that I'm standing here with this man who fought so that I could just live, be able to live in a place where in the deed it said, you cannot sell to niggas or Jews. In the deed, those words. So his fight and what he's accomplished and what he's done allowed me to be here. And this studio is in the district that elected him year after, all of those years. So I'm so moved by him, so proud of him, and I'm just glad that I had an opportunity to know him, C.T. Vivian, as well as Joseph Lowery, all in within a matter of months, they all passed.